दैट इज ऑल्सो बींग गवर्न बाई यूजिंग सम सेट ऑफ सॉफ्टवेयर. सो दैट इज सपोज टू बी नोन एज योर सॉफ्टवेयर डिफाइंड नेटवर्क. How does it take place? That I'll let you know. In the next definition, you can see it is basically a framework which allow your network administrator to automatically and dynamically manage and control a large number of network devices. Two important points to be captured here are automatically and dynamically. Why automatically and why dynamically? Let's say in an organization, there are 100 people working. And they have five servers who manage the data of those 100 people. Now, so at the end of the financial year, 10 people would put off their resignation from that organization. Now, whatever the server you are using over that place is obviously underutilized because you don't have to manage the data of some 10 people. So what will you do? You'll again call the particular server provider or the hardware provider. They will just recheck everything, reconfigure, and then even though it becomes underutilized only, means they cannot take a part out of that. Okay. Now, again, if 10 more people join, it becomes 110. First of all, the example was for 90, from 100 to 90, and now it is 110. So what will happen in that case? Now you again have to call that service provider. They'll just reconfigure, put all those things. So it is a static way of managing the things. But let's say if this can be managed dynamically, then how will you handle these things? Means whatever the people come or go, you just have to pay for pay as you go model. Means your servers are being managed by some other person. You have to just let them know that 10 more people would be joining me from May 2021. And I want this much of server capacity, or let's say processing capacity. They'll say, okay, no problem. Till now we were charging you 100 euros. Now we will charge you 125 euros for that. So you find it more convenient because you don't have to take any hassle of managing any servers or to looking after the wear and tear, or you can say the operation and maintenance of them. So that is dynamically. And why automatically? Means the moment your 10 people even leave or they join, you just have to put application, or you just don't have to do anything. You just have to inform your service provider that, okay, I want so and so thing from this date. They will also run some set of commands because they already have a large, huge amount of storage and compute available with them. All they need to do is that was unutilized, or that were in their particular control. Now they have given it to you. So that is automatically and dynamically. So all the network devices are controlled like that. It is only not confined to network devices. It can be the services, that means network services, the topologies, the traffic path, and the way you handle the packets. This is one of the most important things. Why packet handling is used there? See, when you transfer a packet from point A to point B, there are several headers which are being put on a packet, a topology is there. Okay, the CRC bits are being sent with the packets. When they reach from source to destination, the redundancy check takes place. They are reassembled into proper format. Then only you will come to see that, okay, this is the particular form of the information that intender wants to send to me. Now let's look at this diagram. So when looking at this diagram, you can see there were four different network devices. These can be switches, routers, whatever it can be, who have some data inside them. Now, if all of them use their individual brain, so someone will send in this direction, somebody may send in this, somebody may send in this, and someone might send in this direction. Difficult to manage, right? But what you have done, you virtualize them. You combine them all together using some set of softwares. So what came to existence? SDN controller. Next is what your SDN controller. Why it is control plane? Because this is managing, this is a centralized control, although you can say the brain of all these things, right? Now, whatever network applications are running on the management plane do not have to communicate with any of the underlying network hardware devices. You just have to virtualize them based on the previous slide, as I told, network function virtualization. The moment you have virtualized it, they transform into a centralized controller. Now, whatever network application you wish to run, you can run. So that's why this is known as a software-defined network. Data was transferred from these switches or routers or network devices to this network app, or you can say to the management plane earlier also. But the topology was different, controlling mechanism was different. But it's not like that. Now you have a centralized controller and then you can run the desired network application, or you can host the desired network application on the top of this. There are some interconnected or intermediate devices, which is not a part of this diagram, but actually that's a different detailed topic. Now let's see how does software-defined network came into existence. There's a word which is known as OpenFlow. What is OpenFlow? It is the standard defined by ONF, Open Networking Foundation, for implementing the software-defined networking network equipment. Basically, OpenFlow is what? Your particular standard is being created by some organization, which is giving you some set of instructions that you need to follow, so and so instructions, in which you will have your OpenFlow controller, you will have OpenFlow switch, okay, or you will have some set of protocols. Protocol is what? The set of commands. Or in easy language, you can say like that, ONF has given some set of commands or some set of instructions that please do virtualize the entire underlying hardware and whatever networking you wish to have. It can be LAN, it can be WAN, it can be anything. Manage everything by using the softwares. Whatever the underlying hardware is there, leave it. Does not make any difference. So this is how the software-defined networking came into existence. So this is your SDN. Now, let's say if some organization has 10 different offices in India, they all are interconnected with each other. But again, there was an issue. The count of employees goes ups and down, or whatever the requirements are there, they may increase or decrease with time. So in order to avoid all those problems, they are now transforming their network to get connected using SD-WAN, Software-Defined Wide Area Network, which is your advanced version of WAN. So this is one of the major advantages of introducing your software-defined network. And the third topic for the day is Open RAN. Most of you might have heard of radio access network. From this term itself, you can understand why it is known as access network. As I told in the previous slide also, you will never come to see an optical fiber in front of you. Though your data or your information is flowing through it, you'll never come to see Ethernet cable. You will never come to see a multiplexer or demultiplexer. You know these all exist into a network, but yeah, obviously you can see a mobile tower. You can also see a base station transceiver. You can also see the GSM antennas. Okay, you can also see your like the antennas, like there are Yagi antennas, or you can see GSM antennas, microwave antennas, that also you can see. So what I wish to convey is that the network which is directly accessible by the user, the moment you dial your like from a mobile number, you does not see what exactly is the core behind or the transport network. You just see, okay, I'm in a coverage, that's it. Means you can access it directly. That's why it is supposed to be known as radio access network. And this has been like into existence from the time of your 1G, or you can say 2G. What exactly is being done in radio access network? Your electromagnetic waves or radio waves, whatever are there, they are just propagating or flowing, which is carrying your information into the form of sine or cosine signal. Sinusoidal or cosine signal, like that it is going. As I told you, this journey started from 1G and now it is reaching to 5G, and later on it will go to 6, 7. Let's see in the future, where does it go? Now, let's say if there is the X, Y, Z, three different service providers. Now, X service provider is saying, I will offer you the service, but only thing is that each and every point should be connected with my equipment. I'll not allow any other person to communicate with my equipment. I will create a firewall, I'll create such kind of stoppage or obstacles that you will not be able to communicate, or you will not able to come inside my equipment or my nodes. Now, what will Y and Z do? Same argument is being put over by Y and Z. In order to avoid all these problems or to establish the communication in a free manner, what we have done is that we have introduced Open RAN. Means there would be a unified hardware. Let me explain you in a very simple manner. There was a time when you have to transfer the money from one person to another person. You have to take the bank account number, you have to take the IFSC code, you have to check it several times. Okay, that if one of the digit goes wrong, the amount to transfer may not get transferred to the person whom you wish to have it. In order to avoid all that problem, what is being introduced by the government? Unified payment interface, the UPI. You use Google Pay, you use Phone Pay, Paytm, or there are several things, Amazon Pay, whatever you use. You just have to check the mobile number of that person. Okay, you have the mobile number, you can simply transfer the amount, because that mobile number is acting as a virtual payment interface, which is basically a virtual platform for the bank account number, which is connect at the back end. So the similar concept, or you can say a somewhat of relative concept, is introduced here. You would have a unified hardware, which is basically your COTS hardware. COTS hardware is just a kind of disk array tape or server, you can say. Now on that hardware, you have open interfaces. Initial times, what happened when I told you XYZ three vendors are there and they do not wish to communicate with each other, then how the communication would take place? But in this case, it will not happen like that. Your XYZ, all of them are using the same COTS hardware. The interfaces are again open. When the interfaces are again open, so what will you do in that case? They can connect easily with each other. But the only concern was security. That let's say if some unwanted elements peeps inside your network, what will you do in that case? So now interfaces are opened, connectivity has become easier, hardware is unified, softwares are unified, communication is very easy. So we have introduced such security features that any unwanted element who tries to peep into your network, because this communication is not only confined to the general public, or you can say any layman subscriber, it can be for your defense services also, it can be for government statutory bodies also. So that depends. So there is a well-defined security feature introduced over here. So Open RAN is basically introduction of such radio access network, which is accessible or which can be controlled by all the network service providers or ISPs or vendors based on a unified hardware and software. Now, let's come to see what exactly is Open RAN and TIP. So TIP is basically your telecom infra project. This is a name of organization, or it's a governing body, okay, which is managing your Open RAN across the globe. And it is having only one single aim, to create your virtualized intelligent network. It's already open because we created Open RAN. No? So virtualized, as I told you, means since you have one single kind of hardware, so obviously any network service provider can introduce any kind of applications or any kind of features into their network based on the security, okay, based on the kind of application they want to run, based on the kind of services they want to provide. And it is fully interoperable RAN, means interconnectivity is very well established with each other. So these are the major aim of TIP or telecom infra project, to provide a very secure radio access network across the globe. Following is the architecture. So you have a radio unit, which is at the bottom, ORU, that's wherever you find O written is signifying the word open. Then you have a distributed unit. Why I'm not going that much deep, because I don't know what exactly is your knowledge about all these things, because this is something very typical. This is just to explain you why it is called as Open RAN, or why it is like that. On the top of that, you have made some virtualization layer and COTS platform. As I told you, it's a COTS platform, okay? And on the top of that, we have multi-radio access technologies, radio access technologies, or your control unit. CU is control unit, protocol stack. RRC is your radio resource control. Radio resource control is basically the connectivity between two different sites, or you can say through your network element. It can be optical fiber or microwave antenna, whatever it can be. And on the top of that, we have radio network information base. You can have, as I told you, in the which is basically your application layer, a third-party app could be there. Radio connection management could be there. Mobility management could be there. Quality of services, interference, train model, whatever it can be. So as you see, these are the network interfaces, F1, E1, E2, A1, okay, open front hall. These are just a network interfaces over here. They are not that typical to remember. But if I'll say ABS, ATER, so these are some difficult names for you to understand. Now on the top of that, we have an orchestrator, which is basically your controlling mechanism. So your design, inventory, policy, configuration, these are our controlling features which are being introduced or which are being governed by your orchestrator. So this entire is your Open RAN architecture. It is very easy to memorize, very easy to design, very easy to build a solution, and very and most easy to deploy. The important thing is that this is the most easiest one to deploy. Now we'll come to see what exactly is your benefits of OpenRAN. So benefits you can say like is that it's very cost effective because now you have a unified hardware. No? Multiple telcos could come, become a part of that. Means since you have interconnectivity with each and everyone, so let's say if you're using a Vodafone SIM card or Airtel SIM card in India and you wish to go to US and you wish to be on AT&T or Verizon or T-Mobile network, yeah, you can do it, no problem. You will get a connectivity. You were getting this initially also at the earlier times on international roaming, but that was quite costlier because the interconnectivity to be established between both of these was very, very cost, you can say costly. But now with the introduction of this OpenRAN, it has become quite cheap. So your multiple telcos be a part of this. Sharing of network means, let's say if you are going from circle A to circle B or from state A to state B and you use some service provider in state A which does not operate in state B, then you don't have to face any issue of that loss of signal. No, they have a tie-up with that particular service provider and they'll provide you service over there. Legacy is ended. Means X will not say that I'll not communicate with Y. They can communicate very easy. Connectivity is purely based on cloud. As I told in the initial slides, we use the pay-as-you-go model. So it is purely based on cloud. Means you can host your entire application based at some data center or wherever you wish to have them. You can have a private, public, hybrid cloud, whatever you want. You can have it over there. It's entirely virtualized. Now, obviously, if it is based on cloud, then you have a virtualized network. One thing I would like to clarify here is that if it is a virtualized network, does not mean it is based on cloud. But if it is a cloud-based network, that means it is virtualized. Any network which or anything which is based on cloud or hosted over cloud will always be virtualized. But if something is virtualized, does not mean that is hosted over the cloud. Ease of access and control. It's very easy for you to access the network now. As you see, have seen here, the interfaces are very easier. The architecture diagram is quite easier. This is basically what you see over here is in the form of server. This is the COTS hardware, as I told you. Okay. So the connectivity is quite easier over here. And last but not the least, this is a very secure and reliable network. If let's say any outage comes, outage means any network operation does not perform properly, you can troubleshoot it within very short time. Initially, it takes very long time. We need experts to handle that. We still need experts, but those experts are not only confined, let's say for service provider X, they're facing some issue and that is due to the Y or that is due to the Z, so that they will not face like that. No, nothing like that. It's a unified one. So anyone can troubleshoot that very easily. And this has increased a lot many chances of security because you just have to enable a similar kind of security patch across all the service providers because the hardware used by them is same. So that's why it is very secure and reliable network.